Music has gone up again. Music has gone up again. Music has gone off 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 again. Good evening and a very warm welcome to our distinguished panelists, industry guests, faculty, and students. My name is Aditya Kashyap, and I'm the Associate Dean of Academics at ISU, Innovative Schools Union. It is indeed my pleasure to be your host this beautiful evening. On behalf of ISU, Innovative Schools Union, which is built on the philosophy of design, innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurship, A very warm welcome to all the dignitaries, industry guests, parents, faculty, and students. The Innovative Schools Union is one of India's first urban academic innovation ecosystem that is home to five leading new age institutions. A multidisciplinary community, it provides a catalytic environment to build disruptors and innovators across industries. The unique academic programs blend experiential learning with an entrepreneurial mindset relevant for today's economy. Our first school is the School of Design and Innovation, was established in 2013 in curricular collaboration with Parsons New York of Design and to provide immersive and experiential learning in design. In 2015, ISDE WPP School of Communication was established in partnership with WPP Group of Companies to provide work-study programs in advertising, media, and communication. In 2016, we launched ISME School of Management and Entrepreneurship to equip students with the skill set required to create disruptive and sustainable enterprises through programs in business, management, and entrepreneurship. One of our youngest school launched in 2018 is the Dai School of Hospitality and Culinary Arts, a world-class hospitality school with academic certification of the world's best hospitality and leisure management institution, EHL Switzerland. Building on the decade-long success of the EHL brand in India, the Dai School of Hospitality is its new and updated avatar in the heart of its commercial capital, Mumbai. Dai School of Entertainment and Arts, in collaboration with Vancouver Film School, is our newest school, which was launched in 2019. We have over 2,000 students across the five schools at present. The Economic Times has recognized us as one of India's path-breaking urban academic innovation ecosystems. ISME was also ranked number one for professional education by the Education World. This was given to recognize the commendable work done by private institutions. The institutions have been growing at a commendable pace under the able leadership and guidance of Dr. Indu Shahani. Dr. Indu Shahani is the president and chairperson of the ISU Innovative Schools Union. Formerly Sheriff of Mumbai, Dr. Shahani served as the principal of HR College of Commerce and Economics in Mumbai for over two decades. She's acknowledged worldwide as a visionary in the field of academics for her significant contribution to new age education and value-based leadership. May I now call upon Dr. Indu Shahani to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you so much, Aditya. Thank you very much. And a warm, warm welcome to all our panelists today. A warm welcome to Renuka Iyer, warm welcome to Bani Kaur, Mr. Rohit Kumar, Mr. Kapil Gupta, Mohan Ramaswamy, and Abhijit Bhattacharya. A warm welcome to all of you. All our students and our faculty are here and they are waiting to listen to this panel discussion. But in this, I should not forget my dear husband, and I must also say a warm welcome to Mr. Shahani. It's so happily and sweetly agreed to moderate this panel discussion. I'm so thankful to you. But before we begin, let me just say that Frank Snowden, who has been an authority on infectious diseases, in his thesis says that infectious diseases have shaped social evolution no less powerfully than have wars, revolutions, and economic crisis. And we can see this happening currently in the pandemic. However, never before was education affected. And it is only now that you can see schools are closed, colleges are closed, and the maximum hit has come to higher educational institutions. While some of the schools started sometimes in March, the higher educational institutions, I was most surprised to see that the IIMs and IITs were also closed. But for us, at ISDE and ISME and in all our schools, it was a perfect e-storm, a combination of academics. We had to keep the academic continuity going, a combination of academics, learning, pedagogy, and technology. the WHO announced the pandemic on the 13th of March, and by 16th of March, we had gone online. And as you will see very soon in a movie that we'll just show you a small clipping, which shows you how we've gone completely online. We've had more than 7,500 working hours and lecture hours. And we are it's amazing to see that while businesses and offices are having work from home, for us, it is learn from home and working equally well. And I must say, today there are no boundaries and everyone is in the front row. So there are no backbenchers, and it's amazing to see how the attendance has gone up, how the interaction has gone up, and how extremely we are all embracing technology. And probably online learning was always a support to formal learning. Today, online learning has become a formal learning. But going ahead, I think we are now confident that hybrid learning would be something that we would all look at. But before I talk more about our programs, let me also welcome, there are a large number of faculty here, the faculty from all our schools. There are faculty from all over Mumbai. I've just got so many messages. Thank you so much, faculty from all the Mumbai colleges. We have students, of course, our own students from across the five schools, but we also have students who have registered not only from Mumbai, but also from all over India. Everyone wants to know what the future of the jobs is. And here are the six avatars who are going to tell us what are the skills of the future. Everybody wants to join your companies. So you have to tell them what are the jobs of the future and what are the skills of the future. But before that, I think we would have all met on the campus, but why should this not take you on a campus, quick campus tour to show you what our campus is, it still is, and also to show you how we went on after the pandemic, and also to show you how we have been inspired by great leaders who have visited this campus. And as this reads, we are India's first urban innovation system, a campus within the corporates. Here we go. Thank you. And let me just say one final thing now before we begin and I hand over back to you. I would just like to say that Dr. Srikant Datar, who has recently become the Dean of the Harvard Business School, I had the privilege of spending some time with him on our last visit. Both Ranjit and I had the privilege of spending time with him on our last visit to Boston. And he gave me his book, which he had just written, and that was called Rethinking the MBA. And in that, he brings in three educational goals: knowing, which is concepts; doing, which is practical skills; and being, which is attitudes and values. Today, I must say, all our programs have been able to see this vision, and we have been able to implement it. Very strong on academic rigor, but I think we're one of those few institutions who have really focused on practical skills and developing attitudes and values. We've launched 6 programs in the postgraduate arena, but I have to say we're the first standalone institution in Mumbai to be granted an approval from the AICT, which is the All India Council of Technical Education. And we are probably, and I think we are, the first and the only program of a postgraduate diploma in design. And one of the unique programs, again, is our 1-year program on design and innovation, which is led by a very smart young faculty, Amit Kundal. And we've had almost about 14 patents and counting, and still counting. And this has just been a few years. And of course, we've got the programs in management and entrepreneurship. We have a program in business analytics. We have 2 excellent shorter programs in business and entrepreneurship, and also in media and advertising. So let's just quickly welcome all the students who are here from these 6 programs. Let's have a look at them. Let's give them the red curtain. So even in the pandemic, we were able to achieve 100% virtual internships, and we are very thankful to the corporates who have supported us. But before I hand over this back to the moderator, let me just say that if WHO announced a pandemic and announced an emergency, the WEF, the World Economic Forum, recently declared a reskilling emergency, saying that more than 1 billion jobs are going to be transformed by technology. And hence, what are the jobs of the future? What are the skills? And I think we as educational institutions need to understand this. We need to prepare ourselves with education 4.0, which actually matches industry 4.0. And therefore, thank you very much, panelists, for being here. Can't wait to listen to everything that you have to say. Thank you so much, and over to you, Aditya.
Thank you, Dr. Shani. It is indeed my pleasure to be introducing to all of you our esteemed panelists for the evening. Ms. Renuka has completed her master's in human resources from SIES College of Management in Mumbai. She has 10 years of experience in talent management across industries, She started her career with a two-year stint in a real estate organization in the learning and organizational development team. She then joined the shared services arm of General Mills, where she eventually led the L&D and onboarding strategy and execution for the center. In 4 years, she moved to the India Foods division of General Mills, where she forayed into a new domain and industry. She led talent acquisition, L&D, and change management projects for 3 years in the FMCG space. Last year, she moved back to the shared services space arm of General Mills and now leads talent acquisition for the center. Ms. Renuka has a passion for macro photography and birding. Welcome, Ms. Renuka Iyer. Ms. Bani Kaur is the associate staffing lead for Google India Sales. A veteran in the talent acquisition industry, Ms. Bani comes with 18 years of experience in recruitment with 14 years at Google. Welcome, Ms. Bani Kaur. Mr. Rohit Kumar is the CHRO of Kellogg India and South Asia. He has over 20 years of diverse industry experience across FMCG, pharma, and telecom, and has worked across geographies and cultures in India and an international stint in the UK. Mr. Rohit believes that sensitization of leaders and building line managers' capability is the key to bring alive organizations' culture and values and drive sustainable engagement, leading to organizational transformation. Foodie at heart, he loves to cook and indulge in food, but balances that by also being a health and fitness enthusiast. Welcome, Mr. Rohit Kumar. Mr. Kapil Gupta is a seasoned finance professional who is qualified chartered accountant and comes with a niche expertise in fields of finance and management with diverse industries like IT, software, pharma, technology, semiconductor with an entrepreneurial mindset. Mr. Gupta has worked with people across the globe, giving him a sound experience of working in the global environment. His expertise lies in financial planning and analysis, strategy and planning, leadership financial reporting, financial modeling, project management, budgeting, forecasting, business development, corporate finance, and MIS. Welcome, Mr. Gupta. Over a progressive career of 24 plus years, Mr. Mohan has headed and managed different business product verticals and entities in varied geographic markets such as APAC and EMEA. He's the current and the co-founder and CEO of Rubik's Data Sciences, a technology-driven information and analytics company founded by a group of risk professionals who have worked extensively in the credit and supply chain information space. Prior to Rubik's, he was the managing director of LexisNexis India and South Asia for 5 years and was responsible for driving the P&L, focusing on both organic, inorganic growth and driving strategic alliances. He is an avid sports lover and enjoys playing and watching tennis, football, cricket, chess, and table tennis. He also loves traveling and discovering new cultures. Welcome, Mr. Mohan Ramaswamy. Mr. Avijit Bhattacharya is the CHRO at Tata Capital with prior experience at Tata Cleantech Capital, Tata Securities, Tata Motors, Tata TD Warehouse, Waterhouse Securities, Tata Administrative Services, and TCS. Mr. Avijit has pursued his postgraduate studies from IIM Bangalore and pursued his engineering from IIT Kanpur. Welcome, Mr. Avijit Bhattacharya. And now, introducing the moderator of the event, Mr. Ranjit Shahani is the former vice chairman and managing director of Novartis India and on the boards of many listed companies. He's a thought leader in pharmaceutical industry and a strong advocate of innovation, which he reimagines medicines. He is a transformational leader bringing in shareholder value to corporates he's associated with. Mr. Shahani has been the head of three major industry associations, OPPI, SICC, BCCI, and is on the advisory council of the Harvard School of Public Health. He has a deep and abiding interest in the modern masters and Sufi and classical music. Welcome, Mr. Shahani. Over to you, Mr. Shahani, to take on the questions. So I think you'll just have to unmute yourself.
Okay, there you are, sorry. Thank you, Aditya. Students, panelists, invited guests, faculty, I'm delighted to be here today on what promises to be a very engaging evening. You know, there are two words which have become so embedded in everybody's lexicon in the last 6 months. And that is, of course, COVID and coronavirus. And this is, of course, a triple challenge. It's a healthcare challenge, it's an economic challenge, and it's a humanitarian challenge. And all of us have been transported to the future overnight. Many of the assumptions that our businesses have been built upon have been broken. The decision leaders make in coming months will shape their new normal and determine how they can thrive in a post-COVID-19 world. Today, we have an amazingly diverse panel, industry leaders who will share their perspectives on the major discontinuity each one of us is dealing with today. Challenge both on the talent and business front, and the panelists representing both HR and business functions today here with us will share and give us a 360 degree perspective. Every organization to be successful has to be very strong in purpose, which to be effective is pivoted on three key elements. The first one is the best talent. Second one is, of course, operational excellence. And finally, of course, innovation with an overlay of strong governance. We'll cover this and more with our distinguished panel today here today. And I will begin by asking each one of the panelists to give their perspectives over 3 minutes on how they're dealing with these challenges in COVID times in their respective companies, followed by a question from me. Once all the panelists have spoken, the floor will be open to questions by the students. So please, students, send in your specific questions to Aditya, and we'll get them, as many of them, answered in the time available. So let's begin now. We start first with Renuka, General Mills. You have an amazing set of brands, Renuka, Haagen-Dazs, Cheerios, Betty Crocker. So could you share with us your experiences of how you're managing these COVID times?
Renuka. Sure. Good evening, everyone. Just to give you context, General Mills India Center is the global shared service arm of General Mills Incorporation, which supports its operations worldwide. We have about 1,400 employees in Mumbai, and the center has capabilities across supply chain, digital and technology, consumer and market intelligence, food quality R&D, employee workplace solutions. We really have a diverse workforce, which cuts across all different industries, and each function actually has its very unique proposition in terms of what capabilities we have. Now, really coming back to, as an organization, how have we really dealt with COVID? It has definitely impacted us from a standpoint of the consumer needs really changing in a very short span. For example, being a food company, the demand for frozen foods and ready-to-eat packages really shot up, and we saw a dip in food services. And so globally, I think, how we've dealt with it is to be really agile. We've done really well in terms of our profits and our sales despite COVID, primarily because of that agility. And we ensured at this time to make sure that, we also extend our support to our communities during this pandemic. As a shared service center, which is the arm of GMI, we were as well very well prepared, and we didn't see as many disruptions in our operations. Again, that came from, our business continuity planning and practices. The safety and well-being of our employees is the topmost priority. And so we were one of the early adopters of working from home, in mid-March itself, even before the country went into lockdown. We were ably advised by our BCP practices, and we've been working from home since then. And our return to work also will happen in a very staggered manner basis the prevailing situation in India. And so overall, I think, I would say that we've really dealt with this with agility, really rethinking our strategies on what to focus in terms of the business. And from an employee standpoint, really being prepared and taking the right decisions from employee well-being standpoint. We are you know, just to, you know, add to that, apart from the business, we continue to hire, we've honored all our offers, done virtual onboarding. So we've really pivoted very quickly. And, we've been able to deliver comprehensive onboarding programs. So overall, we've not seen disruption from that standpoint. Or definitely, there were a lot of challenges, but we've been able to sail through that and a lot of new learnings that have come from that.
Thank you, Renuka. The question I want to ask you is, this COVID and work from home has been particularly difficult for women employees. Mm-hmm. And the question is, how has gentlemen managed this? How have you managed the bosses to be more empathetic or created environments which will make this work from home flexible and more easy for women to be as productive as they were when they're working from the office?
Sure. So, I think it's been challenging for all of us to, adjust to this new normal. And it is true, though, that, it is particularly more taxing for women, especially given most of the Indian households still do not really follow an even distribution of home responsibilities. And simple things like, cooking meals, taking care of children, child schooling responsibilities, house cleaning, and then absence of, domestic help has really added to that. And it's really become the ultimate test of how to really multitask. At the same time, we believe we should look at things holistically and also enable both genders to contribute better and balance things at home. So, and we have always been a very outcome-driven organization. We've never track time in, time out, and we've always empowered our employees and trusted our employees, enabled our managers, and we really track to delivery and outcome. And even before the pandemic, our work culture always supported employees to manage their work and personal sides by offering flexible working hours. With the extension of remote working, we encourage our managers to have regular non-work connects, because sometimes in the virtual setup, you kind of miss that out with team members, and to constantly keep a pulse on how their team members are doing. It's become more and more essential for managers to be more empathetic and to be more sensitive towards, their team members. Employees can also flex their work time in discussion with their managers without compromising business needs. We've also had a recommendation to keep meeting times to minimum, because we've seen a spike in meetings and it's become really, really taxing to manage the number of meetings that are coming in. So we've had some guidelines around reducing meeting times and having quick conversations. An easy pitfall for women also is to be too focused on meeting deadlines at home and work, and lose out on the opportunity to learn a new skill and stay competitive. We were just talking about how rapidly technology is evolving, and we want to make sure that our women employees, as well as all our employees, get the opportunity to continuously re-energize and also learn a new skill. And so we introduced, we had summer work hours, and we also had, we've now introduced Free Form Fridays, where there are basically, it's a chunk of no meeting Fridays. And so all the women employees and other employees can leverage that time to really recuperate and plan their week and also learn a new skill if needed. The other thing is that we have a very active diversity and inclusion council, and they have, apart from gender equality, they focus on LGBTQ, mental health, and personality types. And one of the early things that we did was focus on mental health, given the situation. So we quickly pivoted and said that at this point in time, mental health is really critical. We have a tie-up with, we have a partnership for employee assistance program, and counseling became one of the key things that we offered. We've seen again a spike in increase in usage of that across all our employees. And we actively actively run campaigns on being an ally at workplace, where employees are made aware of how they can show up to support each other in times of needs. I'm very happy to say that GIC has been recognized as the top 100 places to work for women. And I think that's primarily because we not only focus on having a diverse workforce, but enabling women to succeed at workplace and creating a safe space for them. I think that's what I would say that we're doing to enable.
Thank you. No, that's a very important point that you really hit upon, mental health. And this is an area which has been neglected quite often by many companies. But this situation is going to last for quite long. And I think organizations need to look at this very carefully. Thank you, Renuka.
Sure.
Bunny, you know, Google, what would we all do without Google? You know, Google knows it all. So, Bunny, tell us, how have you...
Sorry, I'll just take on the question. I think Mr. Shani has just had some technical difficulty. So the question from Mr. Shani was, at Google, how do you think the COVID situation has impacted the talent landscape?
Yeah,
can you
thanks.
Hear me now?
Yes. Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. So yes, Aditya has just given the question to her already. I think, Bani, why don't you tell us for those, you know, the first 2-3 minutes on how did you manage these challenges?
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks, Mr. Ranjit Sani and Mrs. Indu Sani and Aditya for a very warm welcome. I think it's great to see this, you all bringing this group together. And the times are tough and we are in a global pandemic. But I think it's really important to always see the positive side and to, you know, see where we can move forward. So really being very excited and also humbled to be part of this group. It was a pleasure to see, you know, your campus video. I think it was really fascinating and it made me feel like going back to college again. So thank you very much for also sharing a lot more information about your campuses.
Can you hear me
I haven't
now?
Visited ever.
Ranjit, I think you should move in over here next to me. We are in the same house, so I think we can share the video. Let's continue. Sorry, Bani, go ahead. You were saying something.
Yeah, so I was just saying I'm really humbled to be part of this group. To answer the question, and I'm going to go a little more general on this. I think how has COVID situation generally impacted the talent acquisition landscape in India? And I would say like this has been what a year to be alive. What a year to be in a situation where we are really driving what future will hold. So I definitely believe that all of us here in this room, in this virtual room together are really, really very special and privileged to be discussing and thinking through and building our own future. On that piece, I also feel like this year has been unique for the talent acquisition market. And when I say talent acquisition market, it's actually both sides, the employees as well as the employers. So I will touch upon first the employee part of it. So as employees, you know, people have seen a lot of losses in jobs. People have seen their companies shutting down. People have been very, very sensitive to the way their companies have reacted to COVID situation. And that's really key, you know, because like Renuka was saying, the companies which have really pivoted well and flexed well have extended a lending hand and a helping hand on well-being, on mental health, on inclusion for all their employees are the ones that are really being looked at as employers of choice. So I think that's the second part to it. You know, people are also looking at what, so, you know, everybody is kind of taking a step back to establish their relationship, not just with their, you know, with their family, with their society, with their nation, but also with their employers. That if, you know, can my employer actually stand another COVID test? Can my employer stand another pandemic? Will I see empathy coming from my employer? Will I see my employer putting me first instead of their own businesses? And then finally, are my employers themselves in a business that can be, that is future ready? So I think those were the important points that the employees were thinking about, that will my employer's business sustain future? Will my employer's business be a great business in 2025? And then how do they view me as an employee? At the same time, employers are now moving towards what kind of talent do I want to hire? So something that Indu picked up earlier when she was giving the keynote, you know, a lot of us are students here, and we really want to know what are those skills for the future? What is making me future ready? So that really is how employers are looking at. The kind of talent we would have hired, or any company would have hired in 2019, is actually very different from the kind of skill set that companies are looking at for 2020 and beyond. And that shift actually has been potentially driven by the COVID situation, the pandemic, and the way the situation, the world is in right now.
So Bunny, that was excellent. Thank you so much. You know, the problem is the pandemic has also caused a lot of jobs to become redundant in many respects. So how is Google dealing with this?
Yeah, and again, Mr. Ranjit, I'm going to just step back and talk to you a little bit from my own lens as an employer, as a recruiter and as a recruiting leader. I think this would be a good message for all the students here to know. You know, from an employer standpoint, of course, the first thing is putting your own oxygen mask first. So all companies are just trying to see if they are ready for a future, which is future, you know, their businesses are future ready. And when they think of talent that they want to onboard, like I was saying, you know, earlier people, if we were to say, okay, what kind of leader do you want? What kind of CEO do you want? What kind of, strat and ops person do you want? Everybody will say, okay, I am looking in 2019, possibly. Every answer would be, I want somebody who has great strategy and vision. I want somebody who thinks business first. I want somebody who can get me revenue. Now, that entire narrative looks like it is changing to, I want a leader who is more empathetic. I want a leader who is able to navigate ambiguity. I want a leader who is bringing in the softer aspects of the business to the core. So that's been a big shift. And I think if there were these one or two skill sets that I would recommend for, you know, the students to build on, they would not be build on your strategic skills and build on how better can you present. It will actually be build. Amp up your empathy, build up your authenticity, bring out your compassion. And I think those are the things that are taking us, those are the skill sets that are taking us to the future. And needless to mention, all of us, every person in the world felt the need to go digital. And that's the second part of it. All organizations needed and felt the need to be digital. Earlier, it was a privilege. Earlier, it was a luxury that at some time, like my 2019 vision of an organization would be in 2025, I will go digital. But, this has been a fast track year for all of us. We are already in the future. This kind of virtual 400 people gathering wouldn't have been possible if we weren't flexing. So just those needs of building those capabilities, which will keep us future ready, which will ensure we are not redundant, are very important, because redundancy will not take time to come. It can come in any day. And that's been our learning this year.
No, that's absolutely true. At the best of times, agility is more important, but at the worst of times, it's doubly important now. So that brings us to Rohit at Kellogg's. A large number of us wake up to your brand every day. Certainly I do. Thank you very much for that lovely breakfast I have every day. So do, Rohit, share with us your experience of the last 6 months, and how are you looking ahead this COVID times?
Sure. So first of all, thank you so much. Really, really excited to be on the panel. And it was amazing to hear, both Renu and Bunny speak about their journey in the last 6 months. And, what got me thinking was that there are so many similarities, in the kind of challenges that we are facing as organizations, even if we are in different industries, though General Mills is not very different. They are also in the food segment. But I'm presuming that, there is a lot of commonality in which what, people are saying in terms of the newer skills, what is now being valued, what are the new leadership traits that you were talking about, and how organizations have kind of leaned forward and risen to the occasion is really, really heartwarming to see. And at Kellogg's, you know, like Renuka mentioned, we are also a food company. When the lockdown struck us, everything came to a standstill. Our supply chain ecosystem was broken. And as we would have experienced, you know, in our own neighborhood stores, whatever food was available, it was disappearing from the shelf. So our first objective was to really make our food available on the shelf, but that meant restarting our plants. And with a lot of agility, there was a BCP plan, which nobody imagined, you know, something like this would have happened. But we were very, very agile to kind of put our act together and ensure that our plants are up and running. From a people and organization point of view, it meant that, you know, first of all, reassuring our employees that they are being taken care of. So we launched a holistic care program. I'm sure most organizations would have done that. And that basically, you know, meant that we were giving them reassurance that you are, you know, safe, not only physically and emotionally, but even from a financial well-being point of view, you will be taken care of. There'll be no job losses. Because thankfully, you know, we were in an industry where still there was a lot of demand and a lot of tailwinds which we were experiencing as an industry. So, you know, if I were to reflect, some of the key building blocks was, like I said, a holistic care program which ensured and assured everybody that they are safe. Huge connect with the family to give them the assurance that when your loved one is leaving the house to come to the plant, you know, right from the time the person steps out of the home to the time that person comes back, how the whole, protocols are there in place to kind of ensure the personal safety and well-being of the employee, and so that there is nothing to worry. And finally, you know, amidst lockdown, we did all the increments, promotions, new appointments, which was a big signal that nothing to worry on the financial front. People were covered for the insurance. And there was a huge ecosystem which was put together to kind of handhold people through their own journey of illness. So, you know, a temperature coming in the month of April was a huge alarm bell, and people were, you know, panic stricken, not knowing what to do. So there was a team of doctors, a team of COVID warriors that we put together internally, and a lot of communication with the employees to see them through this journey. Likewise, our frontline salespeople, you know, their biggest problem was what will happen to my sales incentive, etc. So we assured them that, you know, for 3 months, everybody will get the incentive on target. We doubled their conveyance allowance so that, you know, they don't have to rely on the public transport. So small initiatives like these helped us to enable the organization. Then as leadership, I think the biggest test in front of us was to really, deal with this whole situation of ambiguity, allocation of resources, rebalancing of priorities. The channel contributions suddenly changed overnight. So modern trade channel, got struck badly. E-commerce suddenly went into overdrive. And to overnight build those kind of skills is very, very difficult, right? So we had to really put all our efforts in terms of ensuring that, you know, we are geared up to face that challenge. We quickly put together a ecosystem for analytics and certain other e-commerce skills. I think collaboration across functions were really, really at the forefront to enable us as an organization. So this was really the flavor of what was happening. Thankfully, because of the tailwinds, if I were to look back from been a pretty good 6 months, because most of the food consumption has moved in home.
Thank you, Rohit. This is, of course, the age of discontinuity. Again, at Kellogg's, were there any specific interventions you did with your talent to make sure they're on the top of the job? Anything very specific that you can share with us?
Sure. So, in terms of ensuring that people are not feeling, I would say not feeling ready to deal with a challenge like this, was, I think, the biggest focus area for all of us. So we did a few things. The first thing was that we put our learning and capability building drive on, you know, steroids, literally. So, and we have seen, you know, unprecedented adoption of e-learning, which was never there before. We have seen unprecedented levels of leadership capability journeys. Now, you know, if we talk about the leadership capability journey, some of the journeys we started pre-COVID and they were halfway through. And then there was a pause because it struck. Then we had to pick up the strings again and, you know, embark again on those journey, and this time in a virtual format. And what we realized was that despite a lot of fears and preconceived notions around, you know, some of these things, whether it can be done in a remote environment or not, we were pleasantly surprised because there was a huge amount of engagement. There were bite-sized, you know, content which was being dished out to employees, and they were lapping it up on the go. And at the same time, there was a huge focus in terms of ensuring that, you know, we are keeping the skills current. So amidst lockdown, we quickly designed and put together, like I was saying, you know, e-commerce was the new flavor of the business, and we had to build capability. So full program suite on e-commerce was deployed amidst lockdown, designed and deployed. We did, you know, skill building on supply chain agility, analytics, and huge focus was again put on mental well-being. So we've taken initiative, Induka was mentioning a lot of similar kind of initiatives, but just to mention one, you know, we've introduced this concept of pit stop, which is nothing but, you know, take a pit stop, recharge, refuel, and we are enabling the organization and compelling them actually to take leaves, 0 hour on second Thursdays of the month, early Friday offs, you know, so nothing very different. But all this is backed by, I would say, very authentic hyper-engagement, both macro as well as micro, by the line managers and the leadership. So that's how, you know.
Thank you. Thank you, Rohit. That was really comprehensive. Now, Kapil, we come to you. Qualcomm is a leading technology innovator company transforming the world. So these are interesting times for you. Can you share your perspectives of you tackling the current challenges?
Good. Thanks, Mr. Ranjit, Dr. Indu, and all the panelists. And pleasure to be part of this discussion where you have, especially from HR, staffing, as well as me too from finance. And pleasure to talk to you, Ranjit, back from my Novartis days. So,
all the world, I know that.
That's good. So it's really good to hear the great perspective from Renuka, Bani, and Rohit, being from HR front. And this being a totally new, different experience as well as challenge, because nobody knows what to do, what this will turn out to be, where you have a complete lockdown. And we being a technology company, what you rightly mentioned, Ranji, and when we are at the edge of launching 5G technology right now, which world is waiting for? And when you suddenly have this kind of all challenges and hookups, correct? So it really put a lot of big challenges on the leadership table, especially when India being in a major poster in this R&D of 5G technology, where you have around 10,000 plus people who are working day in, day out to launch this one. And vis-a-vis, you have a challenge on your financial resources when your top line is getting a challenge because of all these issues. Certainly, the budgets, the cost, which is increasing the pressure, because you need to deal with this whole new normal to enable the work. So we really, as a leadership, met with various departments on the daily basis, that what the challenges they have on the table with the limited financial resources, how we can really foster that and enable those all needs, what they exactly want to be. As the hiring pipeline was on, because we have to deliver whatever the commitments to the world in the technology sector, plus, you need to maintain your retained folks, as well as you have to deliver and meet the vendor's commitment as well. So I know it's a challenging time, but great learning and interesting time, I must say, that how it's to be dealt with. That is a major, I think so, a big learning. And we are learning daily basis when some situations comes to your table and there is no solution for anyone, not with anyone as well. So how to delve with, I think so, slightly going apart from financial discussion, I think so the major quality what comes is the leadership, that how you deal with is not being tested anywhere. So yes, what we did is specifically say in Qualcomm, we were not completely working from home as such, because we need to have on-site resources who has to deliver this thing, and they need to be in the labs for this technology. So we literally enabled a whole infrastructure for them to work seamlessly for their testings, their deliveries and all this stuff. So we literally worked out well with government authorities as well as the various departments, and keeping the human side of it as well as the mind that the folks who are really coming to office, they should not be really infected. Their families should be taken care. So from finance angle, if I say, we supported well with the work from home requirements to enable the technology at their home, to make them comfortable to work from home. So those are very small things which really made a big changes. And I must say there is a certain shift in the mindset. I must say the radical change, actually. When nobody is used to work in technology, I think so it became an inevitable part of the work life as well as the routine life as well, where the organizations were not, they were thinking, let me go to technology, not go to technology, automations, whatsoever, correct? It was in the thought process or in a pipeline. But this whole situation really actually has fostered to use of the technology. And I must say, not being from a technology company, being a tech savvy guy as well, it is really creating a lot of radical changes, which is actually in the productive base, I must tell you. So this is what technology is bringing changes in the life of people. In Qualcomm, especially also when we really had a tough time, still we are going for a tough time because of the financial challenges across. And we being the other side of the table, where all of the organization is looking for higher numbers of the dollars to be spent, especially from the finance, we did had, and we are facing a big challenges to maintain and deliver the commitments to the employees, as well as the to the technology sectors, to the world, especially, I must say, Ranjit. And one more thing I want to add here, because, you know, unfortunately, the hard part of the, you can say, the business and the life, if things does not go well, correct, it really get hampers on the headcounts or the human resource, what I think so, Bani or Renuka mentioned fairly, and Aditya too. And so we did that thing in the priority of our whole financial plans without impacting your top line as well as your bottom line, that if we really tend to save these much of the dollars, correct, we can save these much pet counts. So honestly, we have not had a plan to reduce anything. In fact, we are hiring in the full swing, as well as enabling the headcounts to foster the technology for the future, as well as the 5G we have already launched, which is coming in the way across. Okay, so these are the major stuff I must tell we are doing, and we are planning for the future as well. One more thing, I think so, what changed drastically is the way of operating, correct? The mobile working space and the hoodling concept, which is coming in. So a lot of companies are might be either giving up the spaces where they are really operating right now. So that is also being cannot be possible with the use of technology as well as the mindset of the people. Correct. If you want your going forward as well, if you want to your 30, 35, 40% of the workforce to work from remotely, wherever they are working out. So we are working on that front as well to mitigate all the challenges what we do have as well as the industry do have. So this is a bit about from our side, Ranjit.
So, you know, it's true. I mean, not only Qualcomm, but all the companies, their basic DNA has to change with the new reality. And this whole challenge of work from home or choice with responsibility, et cetera, end of the day, bottom line is very important. You know, shareholder return is very important. So at Qualcomm, have you been able to align your people directly with the financial objective of the company? Or is that something which only the CEO and the CFO look at and the others are going along with their business in the normal way?
Ajit, I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time to hear you.
Can you hear me now?
better. Yeah.
Okay. My question was, how are you aligning your people with financial objectives at every level? Because finally, shareholder return is very important. Bottom line is very important.
So I think it's a great question, Ajit. And before jumping into this, what we did and what we are planning to do, I must tell, fighting with these tough times, our share price have actually touched a lifetime high. Okay. So shareholder value, definitely, what is the major return ROI, what every investor looks for, that is being taken care. But yes, as I did mention, what is the time we are facing through? If really goes bad, it really, when you have around 55-60% of just in labor cost in your P&L, correct? Then it directly impacts the headcount, which was our primary goal without diluting in the returns to the shareholders. So we did a lot of, planning as well as analysis where, with the leadership at the CEO, CXO levels. It looked, this is how our financials are looking like. This is what our commitments for the R&D expenses, what we really need, we cannot go back to launch the technology. It was very, very, very limited time was available, correct? And suddenly if you ask to go to employee, stop spending this stuff, okay? So it may not go in the right sense, correct? So first of all, we had to convince in very limited amount of time with our business leaders, as well as the engineering leaders across sales leaders as well. So that is being articulated like as in a top-down approach, correct? And I think so, people understood the challenges that the company as well as the whole world is going through, correct? And is being really being taken care well. And as I mentioned, our share price touches the lifetime high recently, day before yesterday, something. So that is one thing. And if the platform is set right, Rajiv, people really support your resources, your headcount, I must say the family of your whole organization, correct? If the cause is right, it's being supported. Only it has to be communicated in the right way. We are going through a tough time and it's being supported well. Yeah.
Yeah, you got to create 1,000 spark plugs all pointed in one direction.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on. So, Mohan, over to you. You know, Rubik's data science, you know, your customized predictive analytics and proprietary technology provides deep insights into business. So do share with us your journey of the recent past and plan ahead.
Sure. Thank you. Like the others mentioned, I'd also like to thank you all for inviting me. And while I heard my other fellow panelists, I must admit, we are in a slightly different position as compared to the others because ours is a startup. We started Rubix, although we have good experience in managing bigger organizations in the past. But whether we like it or not, Rubix is a startup and we started about 3.5 years back. So that adds to the uncertainty, not just us, but the overall team would have. And it's important for the students to also know because, you know, once you graduate, you would want to start a venture of your own. You may be part of another startup, so on and so forth. So it is important to know, how one deals or what one needs to do so as to, you know, wade through situations like these, which is, again, unprecedented. It's not regional or sectoral, but it is something which has hit the whole world. So we are a small team, it's pretty much like a family. It's not just about 35 people that we need to take care of, but, you know, on an average 35 into 4 that we need to, if you consider a family of 4, then it's as good as about 200 people that we need to worry about and take care of, especially during these times. So some of the things that we did was, again, to give confidence to the team, we over-communicated. Like many others mentioned, we over-communicated. We were all, you know, again, we are all human beings. We were as much taken aback as the entire, the other team members as well. So we had to over-communicate, tell them as to some of the steps that we were taking so as to bring about stability and you know, how we're going to wade over these tough times. I mean, one of the most important things we did was to ensure that you know, there was absolutely no reductions that we had in our team. In fact, we added more. There were no salary reductions, nothing. We in fact added significantly to our headcount, and you know, more importantly, we thought the best way to actually take people's minds off the crisis is also to keep everybody busy, occupied, and engaged. And by God's grace, you know, we also had strong tailwinds. Like Rohit mentioned, for their business, we had strong tailwinds because we are in the business of risk assessment. Because of COVID and these trying times, the supply chain risks, you know, globally went up. So, you know, more and more companies wanted to get their counterparties, both their supply chain partners and their distribution chain partners, assessed so that they end up working with the right kind of partners. So our, in fact, we got more busier. And like I said, we communicated more. We had a lot of these cross-functional teams that were established so as to, you know, also go through another set of crises where suddenly you get more work and you just need to ensure that you did as much justice as before, where, you know, things were all pretty much under control. So I think we did all of that, and we communicated more. We important to treat people with a great amount of respect, give them the confidence. Important for leadership to actually step up and make sure that you know, they show the kind of control that the team would like to see amongst the leadership. So, you know, all of us took up the mantle of getting more customers, working closely with more and more customers. Involved you know, the others in down the line also to be part of some of those critical interactions with customers. And that gave overall confidence to the team that, yes, you know, things are looking up. We are all in this together, and we will fight this out together. So, you know, I think what is credible about our team was that they adapted very well to the situation. It's not that people, you know, chose to give up or to crib about what one was encountering. They recognized that, yes, it's a challenge. It, you know, it is as big a challenge for any big company as it is for us. And the only way we will overcome this is when we, you know, again, we talk more, we communicate more, we be part of the team that, you know, enables problem solving for our customers. And we grow the business and, you know, it will automatically be taken care of as far as, you know, the overall stability and growth of our team members are concerned. So that's the way we dealt with it. God has been kind. Things have
so gone. Just a quick question from me before we get to Abhijit is that, do you use predictive analysis in hiring? Have you seen companies doing that?
Yeah, good question. In fact, we as we grow and as we add more and more sort of team members to our family, we may end up doing that. But right now, as it is for every other startup, our hands are full. And so we have enough and more to manage, you know, so what we work with good partners, you know, who do the hiring for us. And I'm sure we've been informed that they use all the necessary tools that are needed to make sure that we attract the right talent. We attract the, you know, people with the right mindset for, you know, our business, which is primarily in the analytics and data science space, where, you know, you may not get ready talent, but, you know, we look at people with a particular skill set and, more importantly, attitude and adaptability that, you know, I mean, which helps them to sort of, you know, perform their job well. So, yes, as we become a bigger team, I mean, like the organizations that I was part of and that I managed earlier, I'm sure all of those predictive models will come into play later, but so far so good.
Great.
We use just to add to what I said. In fact, our business is all about building those predictive models, which help enable our customers ascertain the risk that they face with, you know, while when they deal with their suppliers, vendors, dealers, distributors, customers. So, you know, modeling is something which is part and parcel of our DNA. And so, you know, and it's interesting, you know, from a student standpoint, it's a great field to be in for sure.
No, it is. I mean, that's the future. Absolutely. Thank you, Mohan. Avjit, you know, Tata Capital, what can you say about the Tata brand? It stands for integrity, transparency, fairness, and innovation. Stands you in good stead in good times and more so in the bad times. So tell us your experience, Avjit, on how you're managing during these current bad times.
Sure. First, good evening to everyone. And thank you, Indu and Ranjit, for having me here. In fact, I've heard everyone on the panel. And therefore, we also, like most of the organizations, you know, took to the water like a fish. So we didn't know that we knew swimming that well, but we did. And we were up and running, I think, even without a day's delay. So yes, our digital infrastructure, our IT infrastructure, all kept us in step. A few things that we did, actually, as an organization, we are a fairly distributed organization. So we are around 9,000 people working across 150 locations. And in such a pandemic where everyone has gone home and they don't know what's going to happen next, our first task was to, you know, hold the organization together. So as, you know, Mohan mentioned and many others mentioned, we over-communicated, we first connected so that they feel that they're still part of the family. And it was quite intense. Then second, we knew that the first worry, well, obviously there was no work because no one was borrowing money when the lockdown happened. And it's only now that it is coming back as a business. So what do we do? So first we tried to address their, insecurity, if I may say, on two planes. One is the insecurity about the disease itself. What happens if I get impacted? So we created a network of ambulances, telemedicine, doctors, because we don't have a cure to the COVID-19, but we can definitely manage it if someone gets impacted. And that helped a lot. So people got, I mean, they were actually, you know, they felt secure that if something happens, there is a larger network within the organization that will help me out. It helped a lot. And second, we felt that this is the best time to get them onto learning. So there were learning modules rolled out like crazy. And in the first 1 month of the lockdown, I think on an average, a person was doing 2 to 3 modules a day. The third piece that we got them to do was, you know, in a frenzy of work, we leave out many things. We don't update full data. We leave out a paper here or there. So we got them to actually do that housekeeping. So we kept the 9,000 people busy for the entire period from April, March 18th till early May, mid-May. And thereafter, we started opening our branches and people started coming back, not in full numbers, first 5%, then 10%. Now we are around 30% people. And now I would say almost 70% people are actually working on a rotational basis. So we feel like a normal company back again with a mix of working from home and working on the field. The things that I observed is that, one, leadership connected right down till the last mile. So it is unprecedented leadership connect. Second, there was a huge building of trust. The Tata trust actually started getting reinforced in many ways than one, not just in just communicating, but the fact that the job will be there, people will look after us in our careers. In terms of family, we included the family as a part of the entire workplace because people work from home. What the pandemic has done is actually made home as the workplace. So therefore we included, and whoever is in the workplace becomes in some way part of the work. So, and many of our colleagues are not in luxurious homes that they can have a room of their own. They are in small, small places. So we dealt with that. And I must say we did a pretty good job. And slowly with time, we helped in reskilling our employees because we knew that we will need to deploy them in functions like sales guys may not have as much load as our collections guys have. So how do we redeploy some of the salespeople into collection? Because that's where the loading is. So this happened in a very, very systematic manner over the last now 6-7 months. And finally, we got a very, very democratized leadership. So we delegated authority, people took decisions at their end. Data got democratized for the first time. Otherwise, data was hoarded by, you know, the people who had it. So now people had the data, you take your own decision. And if you do right, great. If you don't, there is a safety net. I mean, you will not be penalized for taking a wrong decision. So these are new things that have come into Tata Capital over the last 7 months.
And so just one quick question about your people. You've got a very large number of people. How did you manage the work-life balance for them?
Well, Ranjit, to be very honest, I don't think the work-life balance is yet in place. There are pockets where people, you know, have meetings up till 9 to 10 in the night. There are places where you have a very light day. So I think at a sigma level, it balances out. But there are days when you have long hours. There are days you have very light days also. So I don't think anyone is complaining about it. Except the fact that, as I think you asked, whether ladies are having a tough time in our place, I think gents are having an equally tough time. Because fortunately, many people started sharing the household chores with their better halves. And so therefore, I think it's been a great time for people to know more about their own family members, participate in household activities, as well as family members, you know, knowing what my dad or mom does at office. In fact, there are children who know many things about what we do. Like my son knows what I do at office. He feels I keep on talking to somebody.
True. No, I think this is great, Raun. You know, before Aditya, I get back to you, I'm going to ask one question, but that question has only one word as an answer. So it's a rapid round question going around the whole group. And my question is, you know, if there's one single quality that you'd look around for your people, what would be that one quality? I know there are many dimensions, many qualities we all look for people, but at these times, what is that one quality, that one word, we describe that quality? Please tell me. So Renuka, first with you.
I would say resilience.
Resilience. Okay, Bunny.
Yeah, I think navigating ambiguity.
That's it. Rohit?
I would say empathy.
Empathy. Kapil?
I must say, Ranveer, it should be agility.
Agility, right. Mohan?
Same, agility.
Agility. Abhijit?
Integrity.
Integrity. There you are. So you got a real host of collective qualities. But thank you, panelists, for this very comprehensive summary and answers. And this has given some directions to our students as well. But I think, Aditya, over to you, because I know the students are waiting with bated breath to ask some questions. Thank you very much.
Aditya, before you go into the questions of the students, I just want to tell the panelists that our students have created an ABCD. The way you gave us one word each, our students have themselves created the new ABCD, okay? The A, of course, as Bunny said it, or one of you said it, agility. The B, they want to call it bonding, because I think the bonding that has taken place between the faculty, between the parents and the town. I mean, we could never have the number of town halls that we had this time with the parents and a one-on-one meetings and within the students. It's been amazing. You know, as I said, everybody's in the front row. The C is, of course, always for critical thinking and creativity. And the D, everybody knows that, digital transformation. And every time, every class, they repeat the ABCD to see how are we going to make this. So go ahead. Sorry.
Thank you.
Aditya, all yours. The students are waiting. We have over 542 students who have registered. And besides, there are faculty and so on. So let's hope we can get some glimpses of the students too.
Thank you, ma'am. There's one question that is coming from Harsh. I would like to call upon Harsh Shah, who is our PGDM student from the second year batch, for his question. And also Harsh has successfully completed his summer internship with HUL. Over to you, Harsh.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to all the panelists. It is an absolute pleasure to listen to you today. My question for the panel members is, as leaders, much has been said and is trending during these times about observing empathy, open communication, and trying to stay healthy and fit. So what are the best practices that you inculcated in your teams and organizations to make that happen?
So I think somebody said empathy, right, as one word. Yeah. Who was that? That was you, Rohit?
Yeah.
Okay, Rohit, why don't you answer this question for, and sure, everybody's open to answer this.
No, happy to do that. And Harsh, it's a pertinent question right now, especially in these times. So, you know, it's all about managing inclusion, understanding, you know, what people are going through. And like Avijit mentioned, you know, earlier that, you know, the smile, in a broad brush, you may say that people are working from home, but everybody's situation is very, very different. You know, so the first thing that we, coached our line managers was to sensitize them that each of your team member is having a unique situation at home. So before you jump into initiatives like, and out of all, you know, well-meaning initiatives, but at times they backfire. Initiatives like 9:30 a.m., there is a huddle, everybody will connect, and you know, that's how I'll ensure that the team is connected. Now, 9:30 a.m. does not mean that, you know, it works for everybody, because everybody's situation is very different. So we try to coach our line managers to really establish one-to-one deep connect, understand, you know, the personal situation of the individual, and then tailor make their engagement pattern. So, you know, you have a micro engagement pattern, which you do at org level, at team level, and there are, you know, guidance around that. But then there is micro engagement, which is all about me and you and us as individuals. So that's what we did to really build empathy.
So Rohit, you said 9:30 a.m. I like that. So one of the things, Harsh, come on, you should own up and say this, that one of the things the students all told us was that we went around and asked them, what is the most convenient time that you would like us to hold your classes? Because the classes used to begin at 8 a.m. And all of them said 10:30 a.m., please. And we don't mind going late till evening. It's a yes. Netflix generation. Yeah. And we said, okay, all right. And then, you know, we actually adjusted to that. Anyway, Aditya, let's go for the next question. Thank you, Harsh, for being here.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for the answer.
Yeah.
So the next question is coming in from Sharmeen, who is our first year student from the PGDM batch. Over to you, Sharmeen.
Aditya, Sharmeen's got disconnected.
He's got disconnected. Yeah.
All right.
Ask all
right. Let's ask Manthan.
Yes. Manthan, we have Manthan here, who is our young faculty of mathematics. Why don't you ask your question, Manthan?
Thank you, Aditya. And I would like to say a very good evening to everyone. I think it's been a very insightful evening with the discussions. So thank you for joining us. My question is to Ms. Kaur. So gamification is very widely used today in HR. I would like to know how do talent managers use gamification in the workplace, and how do you measure the impact of gamification with, let's say, communication between employees or their experience at the workplace?
Yeah, I think thanks for the question. I would say that, you know, when everybody was moving towards digitalization and everybody was moving towards machine learning and AI, one of the things that, you know, that really caught HR professionals by was the balance between, you know, recruiting specifically is a very soft function and it's a very subjective function. It's based on assessment between two individuals. At the same time, it needs to be consistent, it needs to be scalable, and it needs to be objective. But so far, you know, the way we have looked at the traditional world, recruiting has been a very one-on-one, high-touch engagement, experiential kind of an interaction. So how do we, how are we using gamification? How are we using tools to kind of make recruiting more intuitive? Has always been that question. So I would just say recruiting in that sense is going through that change right now. Truly organizations are trying to pilot, for example, many of the great organizations in the tech industry also are piloting parts of the process with more digitalization, with more AIs, with more gamifications. But what they are trying to do at the same time is ensuring that we are not scaling to our own disadvantage. So that's where we are right now. But obviously, we know that the future holds for us a lot more move into that direction. And that's where we'd be possibly moving towards. But thanks for asking the question. It's pretty relevant.
Thank you.
So, Bani, I have to say that The question, I knew if Manthan was to ask, he would ask this question because he's a maths teacher. And I have to say, normally people don't attend math lectures, but his lectures are most attended because he uses gamification. And he actually does leadership through board games, and that is the most hit session that he has. Okay.
Wonderful to see the passion.
Good. Let's see. Aditya, go next.
So I think Sharmeen is back and she's our first year PGDM student. Over to you, Sharmeen.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you all respected panelists. Thanks for being here with us and sharing your valuable insights. With the advent of the new normal, how and where can organizations draw the line between automation and human intervention?
I think that would be for Mohan. Would you want to take that up, Mohan?
Sure, absolutely. In fact, this is a common question that gets posed by even our customers, where there is a fair bit of automation which is part of our world for sure. Because when we do risk assessments for our customers, and they need it quickly. I mean, you can't afford to take 5 days. I mean, it's like this, you want to work with, I mean, let's take the example of Kellogg's. Now, Kellogg's may have 500 distributors. They want to work with distributors. They want to ascertain what is the credit worthiness of a distributor, right? So in a non-tech world, you would take at least about 7, 8, 10 days to find out more about what the distributors, do a distributor health check and then come back with a decision on the credit worthiness and the overall levels of risk. So Kellogg will not have the time to wait for about 10 days to take a call. And that is what, that is the role that technology is playing, where you are able to pretty much, build those robots, which will enable you pull information from the legal sources, could be legal information, could be financial information, could be information from the social media, the unstructured data, as you call it, so on and so forth. So you are able to cull out information using technology in a few hours and using, machine learning and some bit of AI, I should admit, we are able to pretty much get to a decision around the credit worthiness and the overall risk profile of the distributor. Again, taking the example of Kellogg's that I mentioned. So it is bringing about fascinating impact and changes and making decision-making much, much faster than otherwise. And we also got to do a lot of testing. When you implement technology, you need to do a lot of back testing to make sure that the decision that gets taken is it picking the right figures? Is it picking the right information? Is the other factors and the weightages that you assign, is it getting picked up properly or not? So you need to do a lot of back testing as a result. But for sure, technology is replacing all the or most of the manual aspects of decision making. And it has made life a lot easier, faster, quicker for a lot of segments, be it corporates or banks or any segment that you cater to.
So Aditya, I think we've just got last five minutes left.
Sure.
And I think I'll take this prerogative here to just ask them again one last question before we get on to Shikha on, because we've said 5 to 6:30 and we've just got about 3 minutes more. We have lots of questions. We are going to send you some by email because I'm, with 500 students already on, we've received about 92 questions. So we'll select those questions and send them across to you. And a lot of faculty have also asked questions. So we're going to send them across. But one quick thing, I think all the students that are here today are just asking one quick thing, I would say, which you can just go around before we wind up, is what is the skill of the future that they should develop? What skill or attitude or value that you feel that they should develop?
What is your message to the students? How should they get themselves ready for the jobs of the future? You know, go around, please, and you know, you can say that. Maybe we can start the other way around this time. Let's have Abhijit get the first chance now, because he had waited too long last time.
Right, okay, I absolutely find it a pleasure hearing my fellow panelists. So I'll try to attempt this. I think as we go ahead, we cannot fear AI or machine learning, because they are reality and they will just keep on permeating our workspace. And we need to learn to collaborate with machines rather than just managing machines. So Industry 3.0 was about automation. Industry 4.0 is about collaborating with machines, which are intelligent. So, and the major skill is to learn, one is data science skills, and second is how to train machines, how to use intelligent machines, and also how to monitor intelligent machines.
Thank you. This is very good, because, and I'm glad we started the program on data sciences, and I'm so thankful for you to endorse it. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Can we go next to Kapil? Are you around? Okay, let's go to anyone. Mohan, you want to take
I'll
it
go
off?
For it.
Sure. Oh, Kapil is here. Kapil is right here.
Okay, go ahead. Thank you. So I think so, because of this radical change, what I mentioned earlier, there are a lot of things which are being posted right now, and how the overall, especially if I talk about in the field of finance, the jobs in finance, correct? World was certainly has to move to a new era of finance, the new era of finance professionals, and that is really required, which is can be, let's say, posed by the machine learning, AI, or data analytics. So the job of the CFOs or the finance professional is not just to just crunch the numbers these days, just to give the numbers to the CXOs or CEOs. Okay, what is importantly required, like whatever the analysis you're putting in the tables with the business leaders, it should go with some sort of recommendations, correct? They should not really invest their time to read that data and get out of that. So that is a big shift which has to happen. I'm a big advocate of this whole thought process that you should enable a business, okay, not just with the processes or say just managing your accounting or managing your compliances. You know that the whole new era or the new breed of finance which has to come in is this environment. So we will literally have to think beyond the routine course of the activities of the finance, that how can I can add a value to a business, correct? What Mohan was, I think, so mentioning earlier, that they want to do a lot of automations for some company, which gives you a ready information. So you have to go a step more than that, which the step which is being covered, or the gap will be covered by your data analytics, machine learning, or automation, I must say the Cortex, okay? And then the human brain will come into picture, okay? So that is, I think so, what must one need to learn. And on top of this, this new normal, I think so, it will continue. I hope the COVID will go as early as possible. But when we are back to the business as normal, correct? The one quality what I personally look forward in the upcoming skills and the professionals, okay? And the person should be self-start. No need to really give too much of the instructions. You give just some instructions and then person should go with this one, correct? Because people will work remotely, you know? So it has to be self-start. This is, I think so, a key behavioral aspect by what I must look for.
Thank you so much, Kapil. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I think as educational institutions, we have to look ahead and not just the new normal. We have to now get them ready for the next normal. So anyway, Mohan, can you go next?
Yeah, just, technology for sure, as more and more automation happens. And I think also, communication together with collaboration, because you are not going to have those physical meetings and interactions much, you know, going forward. So most of the discussions will be on the phone. So you should know how you communicate and put across your thoughts well. And of course, knowing to collaborate, because, you know, relationship is not going to get, it was easier when you were, face-to-face interaction with either your colleague or your customer or what have you. But now it's going to be more on the phone and more virtual. So, you know, softer skills will become all the more important as we progress, is what I think.
Thank you. And we really consider the softer skills to be life skills, because I think they have today become most important. And I think one of the things we are training all our students is to have digital presence. Right. And that's very important because that's going to be the communication of the future. All right, let's go next to Rohit before the ladies get the last word.
Sure. No, so I'll be very quick and possibly use words. I would say digital, analytics, design thinking, collaboration, innovation, these are the words.
Okay, great. I'm sure my design thinking faculty who are on here will be very, very happy to hear all the words that they keep talking about. Digital analytics, design thinking, innovation, collaboration. Absolutely. Thank you so much. This is great. Okay, let's go on to Bani. Bani, you're the end.
Yeah, I think problem solving is the skill for the future. I mean, you know, we are in a world that's changing very fast. Even the pace of change has increased and accelerated. So, you know, an appetite to solving problems, creating products which are inclusive, which may not be now, you know, one size fits all. And then even leading teams with, you know, with the space of putting your heart first. So even, you know, solving problems which are more human to solving problems which are more business-like, but problem solving is the skill for the future.
Is absolutely, absolutely. Well said, thank you so much. And finally, Renuka, come on, give them the last skill that you feel. We've covered a...
Yes, the last skill from Ms. Renuka.
So I really think that, you know, learning agility is really going to be one skill because, you know, as, you know, technology is getting disrupted every day, there is new technology coming in. And if you aren't able to ride that wave and, you know, upskill yourself quickly, then, you know, what is relevant today becomes a little redundant in the future. And so you need to really have learning agility. And I think that is one skill that you must definitely have. And I think the second thing I would really say is storytelling. And I say that because especially in the field of data science and analytics, and we're talking about technology, if we don't understand the business problem and convert those into technological solutions, and then, you know, put those back to the business in a way that they understand it, you know, that's the kind of skill that will become more important because the rest of it is getting automated. So, you know, slowly. And so I would say that storytelling piece is going to be very critical.
So that's really so good that you tell us, because one of the classes that is very, very popular is we've introduced a class on storytelling. And that has become a hit across all the schools. So this is amazing. Thank you so much, panelists. And, you know, I can't tell you the wealth of getting it from the horse's mouth kind of thing it was for the students. And it's amazing. I don't think we would have been able to plan this so quickly within 2 weeks, the way we did this, had it been on campus. And I think future also, we'll continue to have this virtual sessions going on, the leadership series going on, because we can see that a large number of students, and I haven't seen any students leaving, by the way, in any of from anywhere here. So it's amazing because we could get all the faculty and everybody together. Thank you so much. And we will always keep in touch. And of course, when we get onto campus, we'll all have a good cup of coffee together. So with this, Aditya, sure. You have Shikha around?
Yes.
She's been working behind the scenes all the time.
Yes, so introducing my colleague Shikha Singh. She is the Associate Director of Corporate Relations at ISU. And Shikha, over to you for the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Aditya, and a very good evening to all our panelists, guests, faculty, and students. And thank you so much for joining us today in this session. It is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. And I would like to begin by thanking all our panelists for sharing their valuable insights and knowledgeable views with us on how each of your organizations are dealing with challenges and giving us all an understanding of the job scenario and skills required post-COVID-19. I would like to highlight the most important points said by each one of you, and I'll take a minute to do that. Ms. Renuka Iyer, you highlighted the need for organizations to be agile during these times, extending support to your communities and giving importance to employee well-being. We also loved the idea of Free from Friday, No Meetings Friday, giving it the real meaning of TGIF. Ms. Bani Kaur, you spoke about the year being a very unique year for talent acquisition market. You highlighted the new skill sets to focus on, which was more of building passion, compassion, authenticity, and of course, digital transformation. From an employer's point of view, putting your own oxygen mask first and being future ready. Mr. Rohit Kumar, we learned about the new holistic program, giving assurance of jobs, incentives, double conveyance allowances, all started by your organization. It was also very good to learn about the interventions done by the organization, specifically focusing on e-commerce. Mr. Kapil Gupta, it is great to learn how your organization adapted to technology very quickly, and you were able to align your employees with the business goals and financial objectives through these tough times. Mr. Mohan Ramaswamy, you spoke about how your organization kept transparency, kept employees busy, and introduced the concept of cross-functional teams, giving people the confidence. You also spoke about working very closely with your customers, and we see that working very well for you. Mr. Abhijit Bhattacharya, you introduced the learning modules concept, giving employees an opportunity to do 2 to 3 modules over the time. You kept employees very busy, and the company also introduced reskilling of employees. There was also a very massive focus on trust building, and it's glad to know that you included family as part of your workplace. Thank you so much to all our panelists for your inputs and views. We're also extremely honored and thankful to Mr. Shani for being with us today to moderate this session. This has added immense value to the session, and we appreciate you taking time and sharing your experiences with us, sir. A special thank you to our faculty and enthusiastic students for joining the session today and being a very great audience. I would also like to thank Dr. Shani for giving us all this opportunity for being a part of the diverse panel discussion. And we look forward to inviting you all to our campus very soon when we're back to campus. Till then, please stay safe and have a lovely weekend.
Bye-bye.